And could I just, before I continue my remarks, I'd like to ask all the members of the IPF board who are here, just raise your hands so we can all see you. Higher. Okay, thank you. This program is named in honor of my predecessor, Peter Joseph, for his many years of leadership of IPF. Peter rebuilt and sustained this organization, providing the solid foundation upon which we stand today. For those of you who know Peter, you know he loves a good, in-depth conversation. He doesn't like to spend time on the easy issues. But he loves to sink into the really difficult, complex challenges, which is no doubt one of the reasons why he has been so committed to IPF over the years. And today's conversation is especially complex and especially challenging. Today's program comes at an auspicious moment amidst a flurry of diplomatic activity. The President of the United States met earlier today with the King of Jordan, His Majesty King Abdullah, for the second time since his inauguration in January. 2 days ago, the President met at the White House with President al-Sisi of Egypt. And in a little more than a week, he will be meeting with Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas in Washington. In recent weeks, the President's envoy for international negotiations, Jason Greenblatt, has met with a wide array of Israeli, Palestinian, and Arab officials, business leaders, and activists from across the political spectrum. And he has been praised by all for his serious approach to these conversations. Meanwhile, the administration has held a marathon of talks with the Israeli government regarding its settlement policies in the West Bank. And the Arab League last week in Amman reaffirmed its support for a two-state solution based upon the Arab Peace Initiative. Far from being dead, I'm happy to say, the pursuit of Israeli-Palestinian peace is once again front and center. Our work at IPF is as relevant and as urgent as ever, as is our partnership with Commanders for Israel Security, a group of 270 retired Israeli generals who espouse steps to be taken now to preserve the two-state solution for the future. Today's conversation between a senior Palestinian leader and a veteran Israeli negotiator will be both intriguing and important. But today's program does not come without some controversy that I believe I must address up front. Some have strongly objected to our convening a program that includes General Jibril Rajoub, one of our old guest panelists this evening, due to his past use of inflammatory rhetoric. So I want to be clear to all of you gathering here tonight. We at IPF unequivocally reject Palestinian incitement as deeply harmful to any peacemaking efforts. And we are appalled when hateful and incendiary rhetoric is used in any way. At the same time, if we are to be effective advocates for a two-state solution, we must not shy away from the most difficult but essential conversations. As Yitzhak Rabin, Zichrono Levracha, the inspiration behind IPF, famously said, Israel must make peace, not with its friends, but with its enemies. This evening is our opportunity to engage with a top Palestinian leader who has influence on the current and future decision-making of the Palestinian leadership, and who has declared a readiness and a preparedness to live alongside Israel in peace, inshallah. So we welcome the opportunity this evening to engage in a constructive dialogue, and we greatly appreciate and respect Jibril Rajoub's preparedness to join us for this important conversation. On behalf of all of us at IPF, I must reiterate our strong objections to some of the rhetoric he has used in the past. And we ask him tonight to address how, on the one hand, he can say such deeply offensive and inflammatory statements, while on the other hand, declaring an intention to pursue peace. I fully expect there will be significant disagreements here tonight, but this program, our first Joseph Forum, is designed to be a conversation that will truly challenge us all, that will make us think, but that will also ultimately be constructive. With this evening's program, we hope to become better informed and to strengthen our ability to promote our organization's mission, which is to realize the establishment of a viable two-state solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, consistent with Israel's security and its future as both a Jewish and a democratic state alongside an independent Palestinian state. So now we're going to start the program. I will shortly welcome to the stage today's speakers. Peter Joseph was going to introduce the speakers and was planning to be here tonight, but was unable to join us, and so I'm going to keep talking, and now just imagine me, those of you know Peter, I'm now Peter. Brigadier General Mike Herzog is among the foremost experts on Israel's security needs in the context of an Israeli-Palestinian peace. He's served in many senior positions in Israel's Ministry of Defense, and since 1993, he has served as a political advisor to Israeli negotiation teams from across the political spectrum in peace talks with Palestinians, Jordanians, and Syrians. Most recently, he was a member of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's negotiating team in the last round of Israeli-Palestinian peace talks, which ended in the spring of 2014. If you have not yet done so, I strongly urge you all to read his fascinating insider's account of those negotiations, which was recently published in The American Interest. And is it on IPF's website? There will be a link on IPF's website. It is an article that is being viewed by many as the definitive account of what went wrong, and hopefully will be a primer for what can be done right in the future. General Herzog today is the Milton Fine International Fellow at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy, and he serves as a member of the Commanders for Israel Security. He will be joined in conversation by Jibril Rajoub. Rajoub is the Secretary General of the Fatah Central Committee. He is also currently the President of the Palestinian Football Association. Many analysts view Mr. Rajoub as among the few serious contenders for the future leadership of the Palestinian Authority. God forbid. Or inshallah. No. Mamashlo. He is perhaps best known for serving for many years as the Palestinian security chief in the West Bank, where his security agency was the only Palestinian force to reject engaging in acts of violence during the Second Intifada. He's not without controversy, as you already know by now. He served in Israeli prisons for 17 years, where he taught himself fluent Hebrew, famously translating a book by Menachem Begin on the history of the Irgun from Hebrew to Arabic. I can't think of a more relevant conversation to be featuring this evening than one between such a top figure in the current and future Palestinian leadership and such an expert veteran Israeli negotiator. And I can't think of anyone better suited to navigate the conversation between these two gentlemen than Tamara Cofman Wittes. Tamara is a senior fellow in the Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. And she served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Near Eastern Affairs during the first term of the Obama administration, coordinating U.S. policy on democracy and human rights in the Middle East for the State Department. She also oversaw the Middle East Partnership Initiative and served as Deputy Special Coordinator for Middle East Transitions, playing a central role in organizing the U.S. government's response to the Arab Awakening. Prior to her service at the State Department, Wittes previously served in positions at the Brookings Institution, the U.S. Institute for Peace, and at the Middle East Institute in Washington. She's also taught courses in international relations and security studies at Georgetown University. She is one of the first recipients of the Rabin Peres Peace Award established by President Bill Clinton in 1997. Today, Tamara serves on the board of the National Democratic Institute, as well as the advisory board of the Israel Institute, and she's a member of the Council on Foreign Relations and Women in International Security. Finally, she is co-host, this woman obviously gets no sleep, of Rational Security, a relatively new weekly podcast on top foreign policy and national security news and issues, which IPF's executive director, David Halperin, tells me is a must listen every week. I'm going to now invite our panel up to the stage and hand the program over to Tamara. And again, thank you all for being here. I look forward to a stimulating conversation, and there will be time for Q&A at the end. And then once more, thank you so much all for being here.
Well, Susie, thank you so much for that gracious introduction and for the free advertising for my free podcast. Currently seeking sponsors. but it really is a delight to be here with all of you this evening to celebrate Peter Joseph and his legacy of leadership at IPF, and to be with IPF as it launches the Joseph Forum. This is, I think, a tremendous pair to begin this conversation, and I'm really grateful to both of you. You will find your microphones, by the way, behind you on the seat, so I want to make sure. Aha, okay, good. So I want, first of all, to ask all of you, if you have not already done so, please silence your cell phones so that we don't have interruptions to this conversation. I'm going to speak to Mike and Jibril up here in a conversation between the three of us for a little while, and then I will open it up to questions from the floor, and looking forward to having that conversation with all of you as well. Mike, let me begin with you, if I may, and picking up, as Susie mentioned, you had recently written a piece exploring the lessons learned from the latest effort at U.S.-mediated Israeli-Palestinian negotiations, the Kerry-led effort. And after that collapsed, there were a lot of us who thought, okay, this is it for a while. This peace process is not going anywhere. But we now see from President Trump a sort of renewed enthusiasm for engagement, for negotiations, for getting the big deal. And there are a lot of different ways that one could go about this process, from diving back into direct Israeli-Palestinian negotiations, going for the final status agreement. There are also a lot of ideas out there about a regional approach that would bring Israelis and Palestinians together with Arab governments to try and bolster the two sides as they negotiate and put more, enlarge the pie, if you will, for the Arab-Israeli negotiations. But there are those, I think you included, who say, let's not be too ambitious too fast. And this is one of the lessons that you draw in this American Interest article that you published recently. You say there that it's impossible right now to bridge the gaps and get to a final status agreement. And that Israel needs to take some steps to shape its own destiny. And you, along with your colleagues in Commanders for Israel's Security, and I want to recognize, by the way, another senior member of Commanders for Israel's Security who's with us tonight, General Dov Sadaka, here in the front row. And thanks, thank you for being with us. Commanders for Israel's Security has laid out some steps that they argue will be good for Israeli security, good for Palestinian security, and good for moving toward a two-state solution, but gradually. So perhaps to start off, can you explain to us why you think that gradual, incremental approach is the best choice right now? And what are the risks of going for something bigger?
Well, good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank IPF for inviting us and hosting us. I've been involved in Israeli-Palestinian negotiations since 1993, so I spent the last 24 years negotiating and failing repeatedly. And I've been many times at the point when we launched a process and we were very hopeful, there were many hopes and so on. There was a sense of maybe we're going to make history, and it ended badly, and I don't want to repeat that because I think there is a price to failure. We tried three times to go the whole way towards a permanent status solution in 2000, 2008, and 2013-14 with Kerry. And as we keep failing, the trust among both societies, both people, in the two-state solution is eroding, and more people are despairing. And you hear more and more voices on both sides saying, maybe we cannot achieve that solution. So I think we have to be very careful about approaching a new process. And I'm happy that the administration prioritizes the Israeli-Palestinian process. I wasn't sure this was going to be the case, given other pressing issues like Iran, Syria, ISIS, and so on. But it's a high priority for them.
Jared Kushner can do it all, right?
him and others. So I think as you have to design the process very carefully. Now, my lessons from many years of negotiations, especially from the last round with Kerry, first of all, I do not believe that at this point we should aim for a so-called home run, going all the way towards a full solution, because I don't think they... on both sides, you have the right circumstances for that. I think we have many problems on the Israeli side, given the nature of our coalition, with the prime minister having less and less room to maneuver today, and is more and more pressurized by the far right, some of them demanding annexation, closing the window on a two-state solution, and so on. I see many problems on the Palestinian side. It's a weak, dysfunctional entity divided between Gaza and the West Bank. I don't know how you go about changing reality, political realities in Gaza. It's very challenging in my view, with a leader who's talking openly about departing the scene. So I don't think that on both sides you have the combination of political will, maneuverability, and capability to go all the way and reach a solution. That's why I think you should be more modest and go more incrementally about this. Secondly, I think that this picture is a multidimensional picture. There are many dimensions to it. And if you just single out one of them and focus only on that one, it's not going to work. There's a tendency to think that if only we provide a political horizon, or get the parties to negotiate, or get Israel to freeze settlements, or get the Palestinians to stop incitement, everything will fall into place. But you can get fantastic parameters, and if the PA collapses, you've done nothing. If there is a war in Gaza, or Hamas takes over, you've done nothing. So you have to address all of these elements. And they include political horizons, situation on the ground, Area C, Israeli settlement policies, Gaza, because Gaza is a powder keg and it's a huge problem, some regional aspects, a culture of peace, education for peace, end of incitement. You mentioned here incitement, it's a problem. And long-term education, which I think is something that was neglected over the years. The two things that changed since we last negotiated with the Palestinians 2-3 years ago are one, that the region, the Arab states, are more ready today to engage, to work with us, to build a framework and to be part of this and open space and give legitimacy to both sides. Not that because they care about us, but because they are concerned about instability, about potential consequences of a potential collapse of the PA or empowerment of Hamas or what happens in a post-Abu Mazen era and so on. And they are willing to work with us And given the developing relations between Israel and some of these countries, we have shared concerns about the reason, the region, ISIS, Iran, and so on. There's a sea change in our relations with some of them, unprecedented cooperation. So you can use them and work with them. Secondly, there's a new administration here in the US. As I said, they prioritize this issue. They are, I don't think they know much, but they are learning. And I hope they design the process in the right way and work with us, with the Palestinians, and with the Arab states to put it on the right track.
Okay, so I think you just pointed to one of the things that's much discussed as an opportunity right now, which is the change in the regional environment and the way that that offers new possibilities for regional diplomacy that could move toward a resolution of the Arab-Israeli conflict. But I want to ask each of you a question about that regional approach, because I think it's one that raises a lot of possibilities. But we have to assess how real those possibilities are. So, Mike, for you, can Israel get what it wants from the region without making progress directly, bilaterally, with the Palestinians on the ground? And then, Jibril, I'll turn to you to ask, can the Arab states really do what's necessary to support Palestinians in the negotiations when they're so distracted with everything else that's going on in the region? Actually, yes. Why don't we let you start? I'd like to hear from you about the relationships with the Arab governments and what you expect from them, and then we'll come back to the Israeli
piece. First of all, I would like to thank the IPF for inviting me. And I'm very glad to be here for many reasons. I think Susie pushed me to the corner, and also a friend. What's your name?
Adina.
No, about the statements that I made, and I think that I have to make a statement, and a clear cut statement. Not because, you know, I am saying a lip service to anyone, no, but I think Rabin, whom you are inspired to have this great group supporting the two-state solution, I think the responsibility of leaders from both sides to be loyal to his mission. And I am one of those people who should be loyal to his mission, which was two political entities, Israel and Palestine, living next to each other as neighbors rather than a lord and a slave. As for this, about my statements, some fabricated, some exaggerated, but some are true. And I promise those who with good intention, because they believe and committed in Rabin's mission, I promise them that in the future I have to be more cautious and more careful, because leaders prove and tested in difficult times. I don't want and I don't wish for anyone to be in my position, in my shoes, but in spite of that, I think I have always to keep a space for the other side is concerns, for the rational people, whether they are in Israel, whether in the Jewish communities all over the world in particular, as I am very glad that I am invited in spite of the criticism, and because some, they don't want us to talk, they don't want us, it's good to talk and convince me, Jibril, this is wrong, this is right. And believe me, I am very flexible and realistic. Incitement is existing on both sides. And I hope that a third party, including the IPF, come and monitor and discuss. And we are ready to cooperate with any third party to change the atmosphere and to stop incitement, which is existing among us and among the Israelis, and let us look forward. Now for your question about the regional element and the Arab states. I myself believe, and I was part of this process before Oslo and since we started this process. I think now it's the right time to make real business. When we signed Oslo, we had an agreement between leaders. But today, if you want to go to the street, we had the discussion upstairs and Fufi said 70% of the Israelis believe in two-state solution. But 60% of them don't trust the Palestinians, which is fair. We have the same on the Palestinian side. But 24 years ago, when we signed the treaty, I think that totally was different, a lot. And then we believe that the fate of many depends on the courage, sacrifice of the few who should lead us. And I don't want to go back to what happened and what happened even with Rabin. And since then, I am as a Palestinian, I don't feel that we have the same strong and a credible leader on the other side. But this is past. Let us look forward. Let us make analysis to the current situation. Nationally, I think the situation is right. Hamas is trying a pragmatist. They are not meeting all the challenge that we in Fatah looking forward for them to accept the two-state solution, to accept the popular non-violence resistance, to accept the one authority, one gun, one law, one police, and to accept sharing of power through democratic process. Okay, it's not easy for them to start make a drastic change, evolution, I think, through a process, gradual process maybe, because they know that political Islam failed in the whole region. Everybody's against. Second, they did not present a different model in Gaza. Third, we believe that the countries who have influence, like Qatar and Turkey, are committed to the regional stability and the global peace and so and so. And they are committed, and I am pretty sure that they will use their influence to convince them to accept the two-state solution, which is the only game for everybody. And if we want to go to the regional arena, for the first time that there is no state actor that have the intention of the interest, the motivation to spoil any process of reconciliation between the Israelis and the Palestinians, which is good, which is good atmosphere. We need them, the Israelis need them. We need them because we want them to be part of security arrangements with Israel, to settle the issue of the refugees together, collective solution. We want also them to normalize their relationship with Israel in order to convince the Israeli public opinion also to support the government. We want them also to help us, to support us, to exert pressure on Hamas and others to join the national unity and so on. As we both do need them. For the first time, and I was part of the security system and a lot of things that I know, even some people, some leaders who at that time were against bloodshedding and so they supported because they wanted to destroy or to undermine the historic reconciliation between Palestine and Israel. Now, I don't think that this is the situation.
Okay,
we have Saudi Arabia. We have Saudi Arabia, which we need for religious reasons and for other reasons. And now they are ready. And they are convinced that it's the time and they are ready to be part. I don't think that the Arabs will be part of a deal outside coming through Ramallah and through the Palestinian, Israeli, a serious engagement with frame of time, with term of reference, and so. I do believe that we need them, and I think they are ready to do the business, including King Abdullah of Jordan, including Sisi and others. And let us go, because at the end, we Palestinians and Israelis have to do the business.
Okay, so I'm going to stop you there. I think what I heard from you both is agreement that the change in the regional situation, the regional environment, has created more opportunities for peace. Now, Jibril, you were making the case that Hamas is now isolated and marginalized in the region, vulnerable to pressure in a way it was not before. Other Arab states who might have spoiled a process are now either more interested in stability or they're busy with other things. And yet, you said, there has to be Israeli-Palestinian engagement to make this whole thing work. And so, Mike, I want to ask you, given your pessimism about the achievements that we could get through direct Israeli-Palestinian negotiations, is it possible for Israel to see gains regionally without cracking that nut, that bilateral nut?
I will answer your question, but before that, I want to make a very brief statement about Jibril's statement. I've known Jibril Rajoub for the past 24 years. We met in Taba during negotiations. And I can testify that when he was head of preventive security in the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, he was against violence and terrorism. And during the Intifada, the second Intifada, he was one of the very few in the Palestinian leadership against it and prevented his own organization from engaging in terrorist activities, and he paid the price for it. However, when I read his statements over the last year and a half, they're indefensible, unacceptable. When you hail acts of terrorism as acts of heroism, I don't think that's something that's acceptable to any of us, and I welcome his statement here as a first step in the right direction. Now to your question. When it comes to a regional approach, there are several models. So the traditional model, which was not really a regional approach, was a bilateral engagement between Israelis and Palestinians with some external support from the Arab states whenever it is needed. We tried that in the past, it didn't work. And I don't think it's going to work this time, this way. And I also think that we can get more from the Arabs today than we could have gotten in the past. The second model that you hear from some people in Israel and elsewhere is that maybe we Israelis and the Arabs can, you know, reach some kind of understandings and later kind of fit in the Palestinians. And I do not think that the regional approach, ignoring the Palestinians or without an us engaging them will also work, because ultimately I don't think the Arabs will be willing to do it, and you cannot ignore a party to the conflict. The third model, which is what I have in mind, is to integrate the Arabs into the process from the start so that it will be more like kind of a trilateral engagement between Israelis, Palestinians and Arabs, where the Arabs can provide both parties with space and legitimacy. They can give Israel some measures of normalization, which would have a huge impact on the Israeli public opinion and our leadership. They will open political space for Israel to give more to the Palestinians, and there's no process without us doing things on the ground and so on. I don't see such a process, but they will also open space for them, because if the Arab collective legitimize certain measures or even concessions that they have to do, I think that is important. It's like a kind of a zipper approach where each gets from the others, and that's the kind of process I would like to do. We had that in mind last year. There were attempts at launching a regional process. the so-called Arab Quartet with Saudi Arabia, Egypt, the UAE, and Jordan approached both leaderships with some requests. They were not met. But another problem we had is that the Obama administration didn't want to be part of this. As I understand it, the new administration is willing to be part of a dominant part.
Mike, I have to stop you. Why did the Obama administration not want to be part of it?
I think they do not believe that this will yield results. I think Secretary Kerry, in my view, wanted to compete with an Israeli-Arab approach, and it just didn't work. There were recently publications in the Israeli media about an Aqaba summit, about attempts to launch this regional initiative. But again, my knowledge is that both Israelis and Arabs did not trust the administration to be a leading part of this, and the administration did not want to be a leading part of this. Now, this administration, as I understand it, is willing to involve the region in initiative. I still don't know how they're going to design the process. I don't know if they have a strategy yet. We'll just have to wait and see. But I don't see a strategy without the region.
Okay. I want to come back to something, Jibril, that Mike said in his opening comment. He described the Palestinian Authority as dysfunctional. To be perfectly honest, when I speak to folks around the region about the idea of a broader process, one that would include Arab governments, or a renewed peace process at all, one of the things I get back is, well, the Palestinians don't have their act together, so what does it matter?
What do you mean?
Politically, that there's lack of clarity in the leadership. And let's be honest, Abu Mazen, may he live a long life, is 82 years old. That's the same age that Hosni Mubarak was when Egypt had its revolution. He does not have an appointed successor. 54% of the West Bank is under 24 years old. Nearly half of Gaza is under 15 years old. These are Palestinian kids who have only grown up under a PA that has been promising them independence and statehood and not delivering. So my question to you is, what do you say to those who say a peace process has to wait until Palestine has clear, legitimate, authoritative leadership and these old guys have had their day?
You see, everybody's laughing, huh? Okay, first of all, I think that there is a real problem in the Palestinian Authority. The split is an issue.
The split between Fatah and Hamas.
Fatah and Hamas, it's an issue. Second, I think that we have to renew the legitimacy of the political leadership. Third, I do believe that the young generation should feel that there is a hope. If we are talking about building a culture of peace and love and respect and so on, so I agree with you. But this will not be only our responsibility alone. We cannot do it alone. If the Israelis are not helping us and dealing with us as a partner, if the Arabs are not encouraging us and so on and so, if the Americans, everybody, even if the Jewish communities all over the world, believe me, coming to the Palestinian territories and talking to the people, because I am a Hebrewite. You know, the only face that we see, we don't see neither Mike nor Fufi nor those who believe in peace, we see Baruch Marzel. And Baruch Marzel is a good person to product hatred and enmity and so and so and so. People, most of the people in the occupied territories just see such a provocative settlers. As we need everybody to assure an authority that could function as Mike. Now our strategy, we will work on three tracks. The first track is to reorganize and rebuild the Palestinian political regime. We are engaged in with Hamas in a very serious dialogue with some Arabs, non-Arabs involved in that. I am optimistic that once we will reach a national unity. And here I can say on behalf of Fatah that we will not go to a deal that Hamas will not accept the two-state solution. Stop the violence and so and so and so and so. And at the same time, we have to separate the religion from politics. And we are ready to go for general elections tomorrow. This we will continue. But in spite of that, if Hamas is not going to come, soon we will convene the National Council and elect a new leadership for the PLO. In Fatah, we already had our Congress and a new elected leadership and so, young, old.
And I believe you got the second highest number of votes behind Marwan Barghouti.
Second or tenth, it's not, it's not the issue. The issue is that we made it. But at the same time, we will see the way how to ask to convene or to take a decision about general elections. Also, this should be discussed in the National Council. Now for Abu Mazen. Listen, Abu Mazen is very important for everybody. Abu Mazen is the only one who will sign and can sign a peace treaty with the Israelis. Believe me that everybody needs him. Fatah, Hamas, the Israelis, rational Israelis, the Americans, the Arabs, everybody. He has the mandate, he has the legitimacy, and he has the guts. We need him. But he is 82 years old. Now we are treating Abu Mazen as a godfather, as a patriarch, but he will be the last patriarch. And under his umbrella, we are working to strengthen, consolidate the Fatah movement to remain the backbone of all political factions. And at the same time, we are going to reorganize and legitimize the leadership of the PLO. And here on the PA still, and we are discussing even with the Arabs, because they are part of this issue, how we can go for national unity and how we can go for general elections. But we need Abu Mazen in order to organize ourselves and to do our homework, either on the Fatah issue or the PA or the PLO. And at the same time, believe me, and I would like to say it for everybody, that he is the only one who can. Maybe Mike, he said it, and I am sure that he said it from his heart and his mind also, when he said that anyone is coming, he will go to the extreme left in order to. That's okay, we have someone who was criticized by everybody. He was everybody, but in spite of that, he kept his word and he suffered a lot in order to keep his path, his vision, which is two-state solution, non-violence, and normalization, and to make the compromise with the Israelis. As this is the first track. The second track, which is very important, is to continue cooperating with everybody. And when I say bilateral, okay, if the government is not ready, we are ready to work with the peace camp in Israel. We are ready to engage even with the 270 Israeli ex-commanders in order to exert both a pressure to give hope for both peoples. And even we are ready, and I said this upstairs, even we are ready to engage with all Jewish communities all over the world to come and work together and defend together the two-state solution. I think we are ready, and we are working in that. And for this reason, I came here, and everybody should come. And please, even if someone say, okay, he said so and so, bring him. Okay, you are wrong. We are with you. But please keep the incitement and so aside. Peace you make with between enemies, not between brothers, okay? And we have been engaged in this long and arduous conflict, 100 years. There is a sea of blood from both sides. It's not easy, but it's good to work, to talk, to dialogue, to convince. The third issue is that we are talking to the international community, including to this administration, which I am very glad to hear, and I think we are sharing the same feeling that it's a priority for this administration to make the... We have to seize this opportunity.
Were you surprised that Abu Mazen got an invitation to the White House so quickly?
What do you mean by surprised? Well, a controversial question. To be fair, I am part of the... From the first moment, and when after I... heard his speech in the inauguration ceremony, I expected that it's a matter of time and he will engage with the Palestinians. And personally, this was my opinion and I think it's documented, but I should not tell, but if you pressure me, sometimes I have to confess, okay?
Okay, thank you. So, I'll come back to the question of how we persuade Israelis and Palestinians who are less convinced than the two of you are that there are opportunities here worth pursuing. And I think one of the challenges, Jibril, for the approach that you laid out is that there is an increasing number of Palestinians, and particularly among younger Palestinians, who resist the idea of precisely what you're advocating in your second track, reaching out aside from government-to-government negotiations, reaching out to people, reaching out to the peace camp, reaching out to build relationships. There's a lot of pressure against that now. On the Palestinian side, anti-normalization. You see this elsewhere in the Arab world also, pressure against normalization, even business-to-business or people-to-people. And I believe that... there was an effort at sports diplomacy that the Paris Center put together, a soccer game between Israeli and Palestinian kids that you criticized in the press. So I'm interested how you make the argument for this kind of outreach to those who say, as long as there's no formal negotiations, as long as there's no path to statehood, why should we do this?
Do I have the right to? Okay, good. First of all, I think the incitement against those who believe in coexistence and cooperation is on both sides. I think even in Israel...
I'm not arguing otherwise, but I'm asking you about the folks you have to convince.
Could the IPF come and initiate some cooperation between Palestinians and Israelis here in Tel Aviv, in Jericho? I invite you, okay, let us work on that. Even if it's 1%, let us build. At least there is a good intention from part of the Palestinian side. And I hope the Israelis also have. But believe me, many Israeli, even ex-commanders and here Fofi, they did not receive a permit to come and meet me. And I, you know, for me, it's more easy to go wherever, including coming to America, rather than to go to Tel Aviv and meet Fofi and others, just because I believe in coexistence and so. For the issue of soccer, believe me, this is not true. Barcelona, they wanted to come and play a game. Abu Mazen gave the blessing, and Shimon Peres, God blessed his memories, he was behind the idea. And the president of Barcelona came to me. And he said, okay, I said, okay, just go and ask the Israelis two questions. They decided the location and they decided everything without even consulting with me. I said, okay, and I have no objection. And I did it twice in the past. In 96, as chief security, I approved a game between Israelis and Palestinians in Italy. And I think Abu Ammar and Shimon Peres went there at that time. In 2005, when there was a small hope, and we started talking to each other, I myself led a Palestinian team and went to Shbilia with Shimon Peres was there. And I think a private jet came from New York here to Shbilia, and I was there. Okay, as for me, you know, it's a principle, and I am ready, and I know how much it's good to use football and sport and soccer to promote. As I said, listen, okay, and I have no problem, but ask the Israelis, because, you know, we have to send a message for both sides that there is mutual recognition. What about the national anthem of Israel and Palestine? And what about the flag? Mary Regev said, no, no, no. No flag for both sides. Okay. He said, he came to me and said, General, they don't want it. In spite of that, they came to Palestine and they went to Israel. The Israeli, Mr. Peres, Zachron Labracha, invited 500 kids from the West Bank. And they went. And they participated. And when it came to the national anthem, the president of Barcelona said, no way. Either two national anthems or there is no Israeli anthem. Because you say that there are Palestinians here. As they said, okay, no anthem. And the next day, Mary Regev refused to pay the buses because of that. And they said to Peres, go and pay the money from your pocket. I am ready to use soccer, sport as a tool, but on a mutual ground. That we are both developing the game, practicing the game, administering the game, not according to any political plan. Or a friend asked, a lady asked me that you are looking for the issue of the settlements. Okay. I think the Israeli president, football president, he should act according to the status of FIFA rather than acting according to Bennett and Lieberman is a plan by administering football in the occupied territories. When Putin annexed Crimea, the first country protested was Israel, sending an official letter. If he is going to annex the clubs to the Russian football, Russia should be expelled from FIFA. But when it came to Palestine, listen, Palestine, occupied territories, is occupied. As the first one to do it is the Israeli president football. When he comes to me as a partner, I am ready to act together and use it as a tool. But as neighbors, as acting according to FIFA, not according to Bennett, so this is...
Okay, right. So we look forward to more sports diplomacy, and I think we... Okay. But we also have a good illustration with the issue of the football clubs in the settlements of how soccer explains world politics. Mike, I want to turn to you for a bit of a reaction to what Jibril was saying about the Palestinian leadership and plans for renewing the legitimacy of the Palestinian leadership. And the idea that Abu Mazen is the unifying figure, the guy you got to do a deal with because there will never be another like him. So number one, are you reassured by what Jibril has to say about renewing the legitimacy of Palestinian leadership? Is that enough that you can persuade Israelis who say, I don't think we have a partner right now, that maybe they do?
It is true that Abu Mazen is the last of the founding father of the Palestinian National Movement. And I don't believe that anybody who succeeds him will enjoy the same basic legitimacy as being one of the founding fathers, whoever that may be. So, and I think Abu Mazen, I do believe that he all along was against, openly was against violence and advocated the two-state solution. It doesn't mean that I believe that if we come to the moment that he will have the guts to do it. I have my doubts. I've seen him at Camp David. I've seen him 2008. I've seen him in 2014 when he came to the White House and was presented with peace parameters by President Obama who were not shared with us. And he promised a reply within 8 days, and to this day there's no reply. So I don't know. I want to be very cautious about that. So it's one thing to have you know, the idea in your mind that you want to do a deal, and it's something else to do it, you know, actually. I think that...
Although one could say the same about the Israeli prime minister.
I agree. Now, I think that, well, looking at the Palestinian side, my concern, Jibril mentioned it, so let me clarify what I said. I said that my concern is that whoever succeeds Abu Mazen will kind of radicalize his positions against Israel in order to consolidate his grip on power, and that's a concern. We already hear some of them speaking publicly. So we hear some of them speaking publicly, and that's a source of concern. I am also less optimistic about Hamas. I mean, I follow very closely what they are saying and what they are doing. They are about to issue a new policy statement. It was leaked to Mayadin. I read it in Arabic, and I don't see anything new when it comes to Israel. They say, yes, if you can get a Palestinian state within 67 borders, okay, but we'll never relinquish our claim to all of Palestine, historical Palestine, not only 67. We will never disavow the, what they call armed struggle and we call terrorism. We demand the right of return of all the refugees. And so on and so forth, and we will never recognize Israel. So I don't think that they're really moderating. And unfortunately, I say it with sadness, but the Palestinian Authority has been unable to have elections for the last 11, 12 years. I mean, the last elections for presidency were in 2005. He was elected for 4 years. The last elections to parliament were in 2006, again for 4 years, and here we are, 2017, and no election. I suspect both parties probably was convenient for them to postpone elections. So when you talk about legitimizing a new leadership, and the best way to legitimize a leadership is through elections. And I would hope that there will be elections. Not like 2006, I agree with you. It was done the wrong way, but in the right way, where Hamas will have to accept certain terms or not run, and that everybody will accept the results of these elections. But what if Hamas loses? Do you believe that they will voluntarily give up on their power in Gaza? I doubt it. Let me be a bit skeptical here.
Okay, thank you. I am eager to get to all of your questions, but before we do that, just say that in the microphone so everyone can hear.
I share Mike and his skepticism about Hamas, but I believe, Mike, you know, and I think me and you and Fufi know this better than anyone, either even from around us, that the integrating some Arab countries on the internal issue with us in Fatah. And you have to depend on us and trust us and let us do the homework by integrating some regional actors on the issue of convincing, pressuring Hamas. But I can assure you, and I can assure everybody, that no national reconciliation, if it's not based on accepting the two-state solution and accepting the popular non-violence resistance. For us, in Fatah, it's a principle. We don't play games. You know, that time, Condoleezza Rice called Mr. Olmert gave instructions, and you know it, even we did not agree. I was National Security Advisor at that time, and I said, how we can let them participate without a political plan, without accepting what we in the PLO deliver to regional stability and security, recognizing the very existence of the State of Israel. I think it was a fatal mistake by the American administration and by us that we agreed. Now, let us say, let bygone be bygone and look forward. Integrating the regional elements and with us, believe me, we can get
Hamas where it needs to be.
Because they have no other choice.
Okay.
They have no other choice. Hajj Morsi went to the hill. Everywhere political Islam failed. You know, we are in 21st century, and still, if you go with your hair there,
okay. I'm not planning on visiting Gaza anytime soon, but thank you, inshallah. Okay, I do want to ask just one more question to the two of you before I open it up, and it's about U.S. assistance. Okay. We have a president who, for all of his expressed interest in Middle East peace, has also expressed interest in severe cuts to the U.S. foreign aid budget. Now, Israel just signed a 10-year MOU for defense assistance for $38 billion, and it has been explicitly protected from the proposed cuts. But Egypt, Jordan, and the Palestinian Authority are on the chopping block. Now, I have to be honest with you, when I talk to members of Congress about aid to the Palestinian Authority, here's the one question I get more often than anything else. Why does the Palestinian Authority give money to the families of people who have committed attacks against Israel or against Israelis? This is the question I get from them more than any other. So, two questions for you on foreign aid, one for you, Mike, one for Jibril. Mike, how much does it matter to Israel that aid to the PA and Egypt and Jordan are preserved? What difference will it make to the opportunities you're talking about if foreign aid gets cut? And Jibril, for you, what would you say in response to those members of Congress who express concern about the way the PA is spending money when the U.S. is the largest donor to the PA budget? Mike, you want to start?
Okay. Generally speaking, I believe that Israel would like to see continued U.S. aid to Egypt, Jordan, and the PA. The PA, I say with a caveat and reservation, I'll explain in a moment. When it comes to Jordan and Egypt, they are our neighbors, our partners. We have peace agreements with them. We have unprecedented relations with them today. Both of them are facing tremendous economic hardships. They are anchors of stability. We want to see stability in them. We do not want to see them destabilized. And I think that assistance is critical. Jordan, for example, is hosting over nearly 1.5 million Syrians today. Half of them registered as refugees. This is a tremendous strain on their economy, infrastructure, social fabric, and so on. They definitely require, and they are essential partners in fighting ISIS. And Egypt is a very important regional actor. We are cooperating in fighting ISIS in Sinai, in facing up to Hamas in Gaza. I think that assistance is critical. I know that there are concerns about human rights issues and so on. They could be addressed in a different way, but not necessarily by cutting foreign aid. When it comes to the PA, I think there are two conflicting considerations here, and I want to address them. On the one hand, I think it's clear that the PA cannot survive economically without external assistance. They cannot. They need that. And no matter, you know, even those who say very harsh things about the PA, I don't think the Israeli government wants to see the PA collapse. It's not in our interest. If they collapse, they collapse on us. We have to bear the burden, economically, politically, security-wise, and so on. It's not in our interest. So if that assistance stops, they may collapse economically. We've been in, you know, points very close to that economic collapse. On the same at the same time, there is a real concern about the money that they provide to family of convicted terrorists. It's a big issue. It's they are spending through the PLO, but it's same you know it's the same money, over $300 million a year to support families. And the worse the crime, the more money they give. So now we are going to. Our Knesset is now considering legislation where we deduct from the taxes we collect on their behalf, which is nearly everything. I think there's a similar legislation in the US Congress. And if they do not address this, it's going to be a huge problem. I don't know how to overcome this. It's a real, real problem. Talking about incitement, this is incentivizing violence and terrorism. There's no other way to put it.
Okay, and yet, Jibril, I know from my study of Palestinian politics that prisoners and the families of prisoners are perhaps the most powerful political constituency. So how do you address this challenge?
Yeah, well, it's very difficult for me to explain, but I will try. First of all, listen, we have a system. Social responsibility of the families of prisoners. This is part of our policy, no matter why he is in jail. I understand also the sensitivity of the issue, either by Mike or by anyone else, how this happened. But let us make a definition also. About the settlers, what they are doing, who is funding, who is so? This is a question. And I don't think that even Mike, with all the pains that he feels, from one side he say that the Palestinian Authority should not collapse and everybody should make donation and pay. But from the other side, I am as an Israeli, normal Israeli, rational Israeli, believe on the other side. I can't understand. I can't find an excuse for that. But at the same time, sometimes you have to fill the void. If not, others will do it. But as soon as we have a peace treaty, I think that this means a lot of a drastic change in everything. Means ending the conflict, ending the demands, and at the same time, paving the road for the future. Last month, someone from my village, he's about 70 years old. And he was released from Israeli prison. 17 years he spent. And he had medical problems. I brought him to Ramallah, sent him to the hospital. And I invited him to go and meet Abu Mazen. You know, what did he say to Abu Mazen? He said, listen, Abu Mazen, you have to keep talking and working with the Israelis. I was shocked. I was surprised. Abu Mazen, we have to make peace with the Israelis. And there should be, he agreed with Mike and Fufi, there will be a fence. But Abu Mazen said, no, we want to open. He said, no, I mean that there will be normalization. But I think we have to build a fence between us and them. Listen, if this guy, he's from a village, 5,000-6,000 people, believe me that he is respected more than anyone else. Okay, let us encourage this culture. Let us, and as you said, okay, because they sacrificed. But when we have the agreement, I think we have to stop and change a lot of things. And everybody should understand that there is no more adoption or support or funding or so for anyone who's going to violate this historic reconciliation.
Thank you. Okay, with that, I'm going to open it up to questions. We have our microphone here in the back, and I'm going to just lay down a couple of brief ground rules with which I suspect you're all familiar. Number one, please identify yourself. Number two, please ask one brief question. Go right ahead.
I'm Bob Sugarman. I'm a member of the IPF board. I'll violate Tamar's instructions in one respect. General Rajoub a number of times referred to Foofy. For those of you who don't know who Foofy is, Foofy is General Sadaka, a somewhat unusual name for an Israeli general who was the civil administrator of the West Bank when General Rajoub was the head of preventive security.
Thank you, Bob.
My question is about economic development, and it's to General Rajoub. When Salam Fayyad was the prime minister of the Palestinian Authority, there was a policy of building economic institutions from the ground up. He is no longer the prime minister. He's no longer involved. And my question is that important? And if it's important, what is the PA doing to do that?
I think that Salam Fayyad was one of the best Palestinian politicians. And I think he contributed a lot. And he did a good job, good business. But also it was the time for him to leave for many reasons. But I don't think that it was a matter of mistrust or anything else. But the issue of the development, economic development, and building institutions is part of our strategy. And again, I hope that the IPF, whom we consider our partners, do send a delegation, come and investigate and meet everybody and even give us remarks and so on, and see on the ground that the process, this process is, did not stop and it continued with Salam Fayyad and without Salam Fayyad. But Salam Fayyad still, you know, he was one of the good guys, and maybe even he is promising for the future, and I don't think that he has a problem as if he was fired, because in spite that, you know, he has no political affiliation and he is not a member of the Central Committee of Fatah, but he was a good technocrat.
Thank you. Where is our microphone? Ah, yes.
Good evening, Jeff Stern. Can we talk for a minute about what's really happening in Gaza? It seems, and I'll speak first for General Herzog, it seems as if things are deteriorating pretty rapidly. And the risk of a new conflict in Gaza seems to be increasing. First, do you agree with that? Secondly, what is Israel doing about that? And to General Rajoub, what, if anything, can the PA do to try to avoid another conflict between Hamas and Israel in Gaza?
Thanks, Jeff. And Mike, let me just add a tweak to that question, which is the commanders for Israel Security have also made some proposals to address life in Gaza. And I wonder if you want to detail a few of those. And for those of you who are not aware, the former U.S. ambassador to Israel, Dan Shapiro, wrote two articles over the last week warning that, in his view, the situation in Gaza was coming perilously close to war. So I think, Jeff, that's the basis of your question. So
the situation in Gaza is definitely very worrisome. I am worried about it. It's a powder keg. It could explode. I think the reason is that, first of all, the pace of reconstruction in Gaza is very slow. The infrastructure is collapsing. It's dilapidated. It's broken. It's ruined. People who live in Gaza have electricity less than 12 hours a day. There were times, you know, 3-4 hours a day. There's an acute shortage of drinking water. The aquifer is polluted. About over 90% is polluted, according to a UN report. If nothing is done by 2020, Gaza will be uninhabitable in terms of drinking water. There's a huge problem with sewage. Some of the sewage from Gaza shut down one of our desalination plants in the Mediterranean. I could go on and on. So First of all, reconstruction is going very slow. After the last round of hostilities in Gaza in 2014, the international community pledged $3.5 billion to Gaza. To date, I think about 50% arrived. It's very, very slow. Secondly, Hamas leadership in Gaza is not very cooperative in the sense that they divert a lot of assistance that goes into Gaza for their own needs, military or political needs, and that's certainly an impediment. The PA is very reluctant to play a role on the ground. They were pleaded by many over the last few years to deploy in the passages and so on. They are reluctant because they are afraid that Hamas will cash in and benefit rather than themselves. Egypt regards Hamas as an enemy, a national enemy of Egypt, and the passages were normally closed. Now they're a little bit opening for their own political reasons and the reasons that have to do also with Palestinian politics. I don't want to go into it. So it's a very complicated situation. Israel allows every day over 800 truckloads to go into Gaza with all the basic necessities. The Egyptian border is closed. Ours is open for humanitarian assistance with food, medicine, reconstruction material, and so on. I believe, and we in Commanders for Security believe that more could be done, and we have practical solutions. In my view, the first thing to do is to fix the infrastructure. There are Israeli plans, there are quartet plans. There's a plan in Israel to build a solar energy plant which will provide 100 megawatt to Gaza. It could be done in a year. Quartet has a plan to build a desalination plant in the Mediterranean. In my view, it could be done in a simpler way. We have overcapacity in our desalination plant, and with the pipeline could provide water to Gaza, but this needs prioritization. I do not feel that this issue is prioritized in the international community or in Israel in that sense. And it should. Now, I do not expect a war to erupt in the near future. I don't think Israel is interested. I know Israel is not interested. I don't think Hamas is interested. They have a new leadership, which is very militant, but we just have to wait and see what policies they will adopt. But there's always room for miscalculation when, let's say, jihadi groups fire rockets from Gaza into Israel. Israel responds. They feel they have to respond to our response, so things could escalate. We've seen these escalations in the past. I hope we don't go down that road. But over time, things could explode. Not in the near future, but if we don't not fix these maladies, ultimately, things will explode.
Jibril.
I agree with Mike about the living conditions and the deterioration and so on and so, and for the necessity of finding a mechanism to meet this challenge, but without cooperation between the PA and Israel with good faith, because he who is benefiting from this split is the right wing in Israel. Abu Mazen representing whom? And even when we started the national dialogue, Bibi said Abu Mazen has to choose either us or Hamas. As Abu Mazen made a statement, he said Hamas is part of our national fabric and Israel is our partner to make peace. As I think the Israelis have also to stop giving oxygen in order to keep the split surviving. Instead of that, they have to cooperate. And he who, even the Israelis, like us, don't like us, he who believe in the two-state solution should push the Palestinians to have national unity, as long as we in Fatah committed to the two-state solution, committed to the nonviolence. But I think it's up also to, but others even in the Arab world, they have to help us, and they have to help us convincing Hamas, but also the ball is not in, even in the in Hamas's court, even on the Israeli side. The Israelis, instead of helping Hamas in order to survive as a separate entity, they have to cooperate with the PA, they have to cooperate with others in order to have the national unity. Otherwise, listen, it's not easy, but I hope that we should not exaggerate about the election of Sinwar and others. I don't think that he is a real threat to lead the situation, because even those who are involved, those who are funding, who are helping Hamas, some state actors in the region, I think they are committed not less than us to the issue of making peace with Israel and to have Hamas qualified as a partner in such a settlement.
So I just want to make sure I understand you correctly. You're suggesting that Israel and Arab governments should use their leverage over Gaza, over the situation in Gaza, to push Hamas toward meeting Fatah's conditions
toward national unity. Not pushing. Cooperating with the PA.
Okay.
I don't believe in blackmailing and pressuring. I believe in dialogue.
I accept the amendment. Okay, we have a question in the front.
And Jibril, you talk about Hamas and Fatah and getting together and one Palestinian state and so on. That said, there have been negotiations between Hamas and Fatah several times, and several times it has been said that there will be a combination, and each time it's broken down. Can you explain to us why?
Why national unity agreements have broken down?
After Arab autumn or spring, I don't know what we can call it, and you know where some Islamic groups took over, in particular in Egypt, this, you know, gave Hamas, as part of the international brotherhood, they gave them power, influence, hope, aspirations that may well. Now, you know, everybody, and I think even, I don't know whether the Americans, but I think some Americans liked Morsi, and they preferred Morsi rather than supporting Sisi. You know, this gave power to them to say no to national unity. But now who is with them? Who is with them? Even the people in Gaza, if you go to the street, you will find how much they are isolated, even inside Gaza. And once again, listen, they did not present a different model in Gaza. And I am sure that if we go to elections, they will lose in Gaza more than in the West Bank.
Okay, we're going to take one more question here in the back.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Alan Eisenman. I think that dismissing or allowing to be dismissed comments that have been made publicly by the general, simply by acknowledging them as you did, as Ms. Gelman did at the beginning, actually falls short of really understanding the issue, because those comments are central to what has prevented peace, because they're cultural. They're the reason why the payments have not stopped. So I think it's important first to understand what those comments were, and then I'll ask a question about it. Near the beginning of the stabbing intifada, what you said about Muhannad Halabi, who stabbed 3 Israelis in the Old City, killing 2 of them, you said, "I say that whoever carried out individual acts of heroism, we in the Fatah movement," speaking as a representative of the government, "we in the Fatah movement bless and encourage them. We consider them heroes and a crown on the head of every Palestinian, beginning with our brother, Muhannad Halabi." Then you shortly after sponsored a ping pong tournament for adolescents, the adolescents you described earlier, who have grown up under incitement and now will be very hard to persuade that peace is possible.
Okay, and our question is?
So my question is, are you prepared in Arabic, because what you say here really has little relevance, what you say in Arabic to your own people is what matters. Are you prepared to say to your own people that you accept Israel's right to exist in borders that will be negotiated, and that killing civilians is wrong, it's murder, and that we're not going to pay you to do it, we're going to put you in jail for it? Are you prepared to say that in Arabic?
Thank you.
Your government.
Put me in jail?
No, your government will put people who murder civilians in jail.
Excuse me. First of all, I wish if you did not ask your question. But in spite of that, you know, I speak here in front of tens of people and media, and I think they can translate it to Hebrew, English, and Arabic, and whatever they want. Second, you have to be sure that this is not the right way to make business with us in the Middle East. I believe that targeting civilians from both sides is a crime. Please look at the other side is suffering. It's good to support Israel. It's good to be careful about, but look to the other side is victims, even civilians. We are in a vicious circle. Both of us are making mistakes. And I don't think that the worst provocative is the occupation. And imagine occupation with some racist individuals. You know, the first terror attack after Oslo Agreement was committed by Baruch Goldstein. He was a doctor, captain in the IDF, stormed a mosque and killed tens of people. At that time, I was the first person to go to the media and said that he was not sent, neither by Rabin nor by Shimon Peres, and I arranged a phone call between Yasser Arafat and Rabin in order to, but if I am frustrated, if there is no hope for me, I am part of the Palestinian society. I am part of the Palestinian people. But in spite of that, I made a very smart and good statement. Not because I want you to respect me, but I think, also I feel, even when Susie said, I said that they cornered me, because I want to see everybody, Jewish, non-Jewish, to support me, to help me in ending the occupation. I don't believe, and I think Mike said it, and Mike also is a good Israeli fighter. He said Jibril maybe was the first, the only Palestinian chief security when I had an army under my command. I rejected and I was criticized by everybody. And no one can put me in jail because I say this or that. I am against violence. I am supporting the non-violence popular resistance. And I am ready to unite our efforts with those Israelis who believe the same and come and fight with us against occupation, Israelis and Palestinians, to end the occupation and to have a Palestinian state next to the state of Israel. And thank you.
Thank you. Mike, any last words?
Well, I think someone who's experienced Israeli-Palestinian negotiations for many, many years, I never despair. I don't want us to despair. I always maintain hope, even in very difficult times. And I am hopeful that both leaders and peoples and everybody is involved will draw lessons from mistakes and do the right thing, and because this is our future. And we cannot choose our neighbors and they cannot choose their neighbors. We have to live together in that same piece of land. And we ultimately have to think about the future, about the young generation, about our kids. I have a son who serves in the army. I'm concerned about him. And I want the future generations to have a hope and better future. And so I want to send a message of hope with all my pessimism. Thank you.
Thank you. And I want to thank you both for sharing your lessons with us, lessons that that you've won through hard experience over 25 years working together. And let me turn it over to David to
close
us out.
Please join me in thanking this wonderful panel. You know, we began this conversation with a lot of questions, and I think we're ending it in two sort of ways. One with even more questions and wishing we had a lot more time. And so I know that Peter Joseph couldn't make it, but I know because of those two things, it would be Peter approved, this conversation. I want to thank you all for being here. The work ahead is not easy, as this conversation demonstrated. But IPF is committed to the work ahead. We will be engaging in programs all over the country, back in New York very soon, in the next month alone, programs in New York, Washington, Boston, Los Angeles, and Chicago, all designed for those two goals we've talked a lot about today, Israel's security and the preservation and advancement of two states. I want to thank you all for being here, and I look forward to seeing you again in the work ahead. Thank you very much.